So today, if you would take your Bibles with me and open to the book of Matthew, we'd like to read this morning from Matthew chapter 28. And as you're finding your way there, I want to begin by asking a question today, a rhetorical question. But let's just consider today for a moment as you're turning to Matthew 28. How is it that a few fishermen, a few tax collectors and farmers would grow and multiply into a movement today that we call the Church of Jesus Christ? It's nearly 2,000 years after the fact that Jesus died upon the cross. And I don't know if you know this, but statistically they say that there are enough followers of Jesus, or at least those who self-identify themselves as being a follower of Christ, that almost one out of every three people on the planet. How is this possible? One word: the resurrection. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is the reason that we have the church today. The reason that you and I are gathered here today is because of this wonderful fact in our history. You know, not only do we celebrate and we had a wonderful time of fellowship, but the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the one single event in all of history that has so impacted the world unlike any other event before or since. And unlike the followers of Jesus, consider this. Jesus, he never wrote a book. Yet we understand that there are more books today written about Jesus than any other subject. Do you know that? He never wrote a single book. Jesus, to my knowledge, never composed a single record, CD, or even song that we know of. But yet there is more music that has been composed down through all of the centuries of time about Jesus. Think about that. Without exception, Jesus was never described in the Bible as being an artist, but think about the works of art that have been created in the chapels or in the cathedrals and in the halls of art. There is more than any other subject than the subject of Jesus. The Bible tells us that he only ministered in a period of time of only 3.5 years. And in those 3.5 years, he didn't drive a car. He didn't fly a plane. But the Bible tells us that he traveled in that place called Jerusalem in Palestine. And Jesus probably never traveled more than 100 miles from where he was born. And yet, we find today, praise God, that you can find followers of Jesus Christ in almost every nation, in every tribe, and in almost every people group. There are people who profess the name of Jesus. Give God glory for that this morning. There's so much more to tell about this. But as we come to realize, I believe that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the single most significant event in all of history. Christianity's bedrock is based squarely on the cornerstone that Jesus lived, he died, but he rose again. This is the cornerstone of our belief, and this is the foundation of all other teachings and all other beliefs that we hold dear in our hearts. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 through 5, when the Apostle Paul declared this, "For I delivered unto you of first importance." What is the most important thing that we can know? That Jesus lives. Amen? He says, "I deliver of you of first importance that which I have received." What? "Jesus died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried and he was raised on the third day and according to the Scriptures. And he appeared to Stephen and the 12. Those of us who believe also hold 1 Peter 1:21 dear to our hearts, that says this: "Who through him you are believers in God, who raised him," what? "From the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and your hope may be in God." Can you give God praise for that this morning? Matthew chapter 28 and verse 1. A day that forever changed history. It was after the Sabbath at the dawn of the first day of the week. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven. He must have been a heavy creature. The whole earth shook when that guy hit the earth. A violent earthquake shook, and the Lord came down from heaven going through the tomb. He rolled back the stone, and he sat upon it. Verse 3, his appearance was that of like lightning, and his clothes were as white as snow. The guards that had surrounded the tomb were afraid, and they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified." Hallelujah. But look with me at verse 6. He is not here. Hallelujah. He is risen, just like he said. And the angel invites them, just like he invites us today. And what does he say? Come and see. Come and see the place where he laid. Then quickly go and tell his disciples, Jesus has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee, and there you shall see him. Now I have told you. So the woman hurried away from the tomb, yet afraid and filled with joy, and they ran to tell the disciples. Can you imagine what it would have been like to be one of those ladies that morning? Just a few hours before, their hopes had been dashed, their dreams all forsaken. They were afraid for their very lives. Their master and their savior, who had walked with them and who had talked with them for 3.5 years, they saw him crucified. They saw the agony and the torture that he went through. And now the stone had been rolled away, praise God. And he's not there. And so these women hurried from the tomb, yet filled, the Bible says in verse 8, they were filled with joy to run and tell the disciples. And what do you think those brothers felt? Suddenly, Jesus met them. Greetings, he said. Come to him. And they clasped his feet and they worshiped him. Verse 10. And then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go into Galilee, and there they shall see me. Praise God. Hallelujah. There's one thing that we need to know today about the resurrection life of Jesus. And that is what we're talking about today, the resurrection life of Jesus. To quote Sam Morris, he said this, the tomb of Jesus, why is it famous? It is most famous because what it does not contain. Hallelujah. I had the privilege of walking into that garden there near the hill called Golgotha. And I went and I looked and I peered in, and guess what? The tomb of Jesus is still empty. Hallelujah. But today I can also report that those followers of Buddha, guess what? Buddha's still in the grave. Those followers today on the planet who are Muslims, they know that their prophet Muhammad, he's in the grave. Confucius is in the grave. The greatest world leaders of history are in the grave. And the kings that came and went are in the grave. But there is only one who can say they lived and died but rose again. And his name is Jesus. And so this resurrection life, I want to tell you, number one this morning, it is undeniable. The resurrection of Jesus is a historical fact that even history itself has been divided before his death and after his death. All of history even points to this fact that there was a man called Jesus. But as we read on, how many of you saw the movie Risen not that long ago? Or even in the Bible series, The Bible. All of these wonderful pictures that we've seen today of the reenactment of these important events. But we know when we look at the history here, look with me at Matthew chapter 28. Some of them saw Jesus and believed. But let's look at the guards' report in verse 11. While the women were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and they reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. You know, it's an amazing fact here that this was something that was not commonplace. This was something that had never taken place in history. And when you look back in Matthew chapter 27, that on the day that Jesus was crucified, do you know what happened? The day that he was being put in the tomb, in verse 62 of Matthew chapter 27, it said, on the next day, on the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. Sir, they said, we remember that while he was alive, that deceiver said, after 3 days, I will rise again. So they hatched a plot in verse 64. So they gave the order, Pilate gave the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, the disciples could come and steal the body of Jesus, they declared. And they would say in verse 66 that this, or verse 64, that the last deception would be worse than the first. So Pilate tells him, take a guard. And he answered, go and make the tomb. Can you imagine this? A dead man. Go and make his grave secure. You know, we see people today when they're getting buried, sometimes if they're an important person, the police might escort them to the cemetery. But they don't stay there guarding a dead body. Why? Because they're dead. No one ever worried about a dead man escaping from the cemetery. I said to my son, we were riding the bike the other day, and we were passing by a cemetery, and I asked him, I said, why do you think they put gates around the cemetery? Are they afraid they're going to get out? I mean, come on, let's be reasonable here, right? You know, this is an awful lot of trouble that they went for, one man, one guy, don't you think? They put the elite soldiers there, the Roman soldiers, the centurions. And I tell you, there's one thing that vividly I believe that the movie Risen really captures for us, is that these Roman soldiers were not baby killers. They were trained men who knew how to kill, and they knew how to war, and they knew how to fight. And so they made the tomb secure. And how did they secure it? They put ropes on it. And they put seals upon the tomb so that no one having the authority to break those seals, if they broke them, they would be worthy of death. And so when we look upon this story, and how many of us have seen The Passion of the Christ, and you see how Mel Gibson so captured the anguish and the brutality that Jesus suffered at the hands of these Roman soldiers. You know, when I see that picture that Pastor Solomon put here on Good Friday, Jesus there bleeding from the cross, and they tell us that the nails that pierced his hands, that those that were crucified, that the Romans had so perfected this that it had inflicted the greatest amount of pain, because as they would reach to breathe, they were literally suffocating with each and every breath. So as Jesus pushed on the nails in his feet and pushed and strained to breathe, he was there in agony, tremendous agony on the cross. I don't know how I could ever have survived that. It makes true what was said in Isaiah 53, we hid as our faces from him because he was despised and rejected of men. Do you ever stop to consider the question, why would the disciples try to stage such a prank or such a hoax? Why would the apostles try to keep a lie like this? You know, liars lie for selfish reasons. And if these apostles had lied, what would their motive be? But more importantly, what would they get out of it? Instead, they proclaimed, as these women ran to the tomb. The Bible says in John's gospel, in John chapter 20, that when the women came back, Peter and John were the first men to take off running to the tomb. They sprinted with everything that they had. And the one disciple outran the other disciple because they wanted to know. Because so much in our culture today hinges on the fact that seeing is believing. Isn't that true? What a sight. What a thing to be heard. What a thing to consider or grasp in their minds. The stone was rolled away, and the angels declared, do not be afraid. This is what he said in Matthew chapter 28 and verse 6. He said, do not be afraid. You know, kind of hard, wouldn't you think? A guy standing there shining in a white robe. It's kind of hard to not be afraid or to fall down in fear. This is something that doesn't happen. This is not the ordinary. This is the extraordinary. This is an angel of God, a warrior sent from God as a messenger. And he says, do not be afraid. I know who you're looking for. My friends today, do you know who you're looking for? The world didn't know. The Jews didn't know. The Bible says that he came to his own and his own forsook him. And still today, there are people who are seeking for the truth, and they still do not know. But the angel declared, I know that you're looking for Jesus. His name, Jesus, was given to him at his birth. He will be called Jesus because he will wipe away their sins. Hallelujah. It is undeniable, and so much so that when the report came back in verse 11, look at what the chief priest said in verse 12. The chief priests met again with the elders and they devised a plan. They were schemers. They came and gave the soldiers a large sum of money. They bribed them. They bribed them so that they would say, the disciples came during the night and stole the body away while we were asleep. But that's not what the real story was. In verse 14, if this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him. In other words, we're going to not allow them to kill you, but we'll vouch for your story there. We'll back you up. In verse 15, and so the soldiers, what did they do? They took the bribe and they did as they were instructed. And notice what it says in this verse. And this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. What a sad reality that some men can believe and some men will deny. Which brings me to the fact that the resurrection life of Jesus, that he came and rose on the third day, brings us to our second point. Jesus' resurrection from the dead, he secured an unbreakable promise. Not only is the fact that the grave is empty undeniable, no man has ever produced the body, and that's what that centurion in risen, he was sorting out to do. He was trying to find the body of Jesus, because never had they ever heard of such a thing like this, a man coming alive from the dead. Turn with me to John chapter 20, will you, quickly. It's amazing how you have to read all of the gospel accounts to get the entire story, because each had a different perspective. And in John chapter 20, we look here, picking up the story in verse 3. As I said before, Peter and the other disciple being John, both of them started running. It was the first chariots of fire, I believe. I believe if we could see, there was probably lightning on their path. As he bent over, the one disciple was running and he outran the other, and the other disciple reached the tomb first, being John. John only bent over and he looked in. And what did he see? He saw the strips of linen there, lying, but he did not go in. Look at verse 6. What does it say? But Simon Peter, the tough guy, remember the bunch, the loudmouth? He was behind him and he pushes his way into the tomb. And what does he see? He sees the strips of linen that was lying there, the grave clothes. I thank God that the grave clothes, the shroud of death could not hold my Savior, but they were there. As he had exploded from the tomb that morning, no longer bound but risen, full of resurrection life, the only thing that was left was the cocoon of death. But Jesus, the truth, the light, and the Lamb of God was truly alive. Look at verse 7. And as well as the burial cloth that had been around the head of Jesus, the cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciples who had reached the tomb first also went inside, and he saw. And look, what does it say? He saw and he believed. Hallelujah. Verse 9 said, they still not understand. Why? Why didn't they understand? Because nothing like this had ever happened before. They had seen Lazarus raised from the dead, but they didn't understand. What was Jesus' mission and purpose? They had not yet connected the dots. And so when we read here in verse 10, the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary, she stood outside the tomb crying. And as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb. And she saw the two angels there in white seated there and where the body of Jesus had been. The one angel on the head and the other at the foot. And they asked Mary, woman, why are you crying? They have taken away my Lord, she said, and I do not know where they have put him. At this she turned around, and she saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize it. My friends, Jesus is a lot closer than we think. For many of us who have found him, we know that he's right there with us. For those of us who have not yet found Jesus, he's only a step away. He's a lot closer than we think. And so Mary says to this man standing there, and he hears her call, woman, and he said, why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for? Thinking that he was the gardener, she said, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will go and get him. And Jesus said her name. I love that passage. When he called her name, the Bible says that our shepherd, the shepherd of our souls, he knows every sheep by name, and he calls them one by one. And Mary knew the voice of her shepherd. She had a keen ear to hear the shepherd's voice calling to her. And Jesus said, as she came to him, Rabbi, which means teacher. Do not hold to me, Jesus said, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, for I am returning to my Father and to your Father, to my God and to your God. You see, Jesus, when he makes a promise, he doesn't break his promise. Hallelujah. The Bible told us over and over again as we read through the Gospels that the hour had not come. There were many that tried to seize Jesus when he was teaching in the temple, but they had no power or authority to take him. But this moment came when Jesus gave up his life. And I was reading this passage of Scripture some years ago, about 5 years ago. Look with me back at verse 7. There's something that is so profound and amazing here that when we read this, the first time I read it, I didn't get it. And I felt like it is worthy of sharing again. In verse 7, it says that they saw the burial clothes that Joseph of Arimathea had wrapped around the body of Jesus. Depending on the translation that you're reading, the NIV says the cloth, there was another cloth that was folded up by itself like a napkin. Depending on your translation, there's a napkin that was there at the tomb and it was folded away from the grave clothes. And when you read this passage of Scripture, it is only found in John's Gospel that it says, and the napkin was still folded. I never understood before why that in all of the accounts of the resurrection, this passage of Scripture, John, being a writer who was inspired by the Holy Spirit, why would he write this? What does this folded napkin mean in the story of the resurrection? Well, my friends, it wasn't until I came across the story or the sermon by the late Dr. Clyde Box about the folded napkin. We have to understand that there is what they called the legend of the folded napkin, that we'd have to take a trip back in time just for a moment to understand the Jewish customs and the traditions of the day. A folded napkin had much to do with the relationship of a servant and their master. In those days, there were those that served, and there were those in the household. Some of them were born into slaves. Some of them were sold into slavery. But in the Jewish customs and the traditions of the day, this relationship responded to those of servants and their masters. And so when a master would sit at the table, the servant would prepare all the food, and the master would sit and dine. And it was the job of the servant to go just within ear call of the master. And so when the table was set, the servant would then go and leave the room, but be standing close by. And the servant would come and check if the master was still at the table. And if the master had finished the table, it was a custom in that day to take a napkin such as this and to wipe their mouth, wipe the hands. And of course, being Jewish, they had a beard in case any food got in there. They took that napkin. And a napkin that was taken at the end of the meal was often crinkled and wrinkled. They would take it and wad it up, and then they would place the napkin at the table. This was a sign to the servant that I'm finished. I don't require any more service. And only when the napkin was wadded up and placed there did the servant have the authority to come and touch the table. If the napkin was not wadded up, signifying that it was finished, there was no right to touch the table. But on the other hand, the folded napkin, if the master would rise from the table, wiping his mouth, his hands, and of course his beard, if a folded napkin was placed there at the table, it meant something entirely different. And here, my friends, is that parallel that we have to take this morning. That folded napkin meant, I'm coming back. I'm not finished. Hallelujah. There's more to come. A folded napkin, hallelujah, represented to the servant that I, the master, am not done. Hallelujah. I'm not finished. Jesus placed a folded napkin in the tomb, hallelujah, on resurrection morning to tell us something. You and I who are called by his name, the servants of the living God, Jesus is saying, not only am I risen, church, but I'm not finished yet. I'm coming back. I am going to be returning with power and with might in my hands. This folded napkin, and the napkin is still folded, reminds us that Jesus made an unbreakable promise, and Jesus keeps His promise. He said that the Son of Man would be lifted up on the cross, and that all men would draw unto Me. Well, it didn't happen unless there was a third day. Jesus was buried and dead on the first day, and nothing happened. Probably the sun refused to shine, the birds probably didn't sing. And the second day, the disciples, they were hiding out for fear of their lives. But thanks be to God, there was a third day coming. And the Bible says, on the third day, Jesus rose from the dead. Look, what does it say there? The angel said in Matthew 28 that Jesus, verse 6, He is risen just like He said. Hallelujah. I want to declare to you this morning that the promises of God are yes and yes. And when God makes a promise, He keeps His promise. Hallelujah. God never breaks a promise. Can you give God glory for that this morning? No matter how devastating the struggles are that we have faced thus far, no matter the disappointments that some of us in this room have had in our lifetime, I can only begin to imagine those things that we once believed in, the dreams and the disappointments that have happened, or the troubles that some of us have experienced in this life. All of these things remind us that they're only temporary when we look at the resurrection of Jesus. Listen carefully this morning. No matter what has happened to you, praise God. No matter what is in your past, it doesn't matter what the depth of the tragedy or the intensity of the pain that you have gone through or yet going through, or how death may be stalking you and your loved ones, the promise of the resurrection is secure. The napkin is still folded. The promise is that the Master is going to return one day. And in Thessalonians, it says that there will be a blast of a trumpet. Hallelujah. And the dead in Christ are going to rise first. Why? Because Jesus is going to come in the clouds. And those of us that believe in Him will be raised from the dead. Therefore, so many of us understand that we live and we died, but Christ died and He lived. That's what John Stott said. Death is no longer a prison, praise God, but it is a passageway to a life that is far beyond. The life that Jesus lived is the life that He has secured for each of us. And this is what is so amazing about grace. If you'll turn with me to Ephesians chapter 2 this morning, I want to report to you about the unbelievable grace. Not only is the resurrection an undeniable fact, and not only are God's promises unbreakable, but we read about in Ephesians chapter 2 that grace is unbelievable. It is scandalous. And notice what does it say here in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1. Read this with me this morning. Please follow along. This is important. This is God's promise. And it is you He has made alive who were dead in their trespasses and sins. Verse 1. Verse 2 says, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. Verse 3, among whom we also conducted ourselves in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. Listen to this. And were by nature the children of wrath, just as others. But I always thank God there's a but. When you get to verse 4, there's this conjunction, this but. But God. You see, we all had a past. Every saint had a past, praise God, but every saint has a future. And it's but God who is rich in mercy. Because of His great love with which He has loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. Hallelujah. What is this grace? The Bible talks about grace. It's God's unmerited favor. It's not something you could earn. It's not something you can buy. It's not something that you and I deserve. Grace. Thanks God. Thanks be to God for His unspeakable gift. What gift is that? Mercy is showing us that what we didn't deserve. Grace is giving us what we don't deserve. And we understand that He is showing us here this great grace. And we go on to say here in verse 6, and He has raised us up together. This is the important fact. This is what is so unbelievable, that when we understood on Good Friday as Pastor Solomon was preaching, that when Christ was on the cross, the Bible says that He was our substitute. He was the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. He took the place that all of humanity deserved. And when He died, we died with Him. He died as the Son of God in the flesh so that He would redeem the flesh of the Son of Men, that we would also be raised like He was raised in the newness of life in our spirit, hallelujah, that in the ages to come, verse 7, He would show the exceeding riches of His grace and His kindness towards us in Jesus Christ. You know what Jesus has done for us exceedingly and abundantly, even more than we can ask or think. And the Bible says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, lest any man should boast. I don't know about you, but there isn't enough words in our human vocabulary to describe about how great this gift that we have received. Basil C. Hume, quote, and I quote them saying, "The greatest gift of Easter is this, it is called hope. The Christian hope that makes us confident in God and is the ultimate triumph in God's goodness and His love, which nothing else can shake." I want to dare to say this morning that God loved you so much that He was willing to send His only begotten Son, that whoever would believe in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. Praise God. J.C. Ryle once said, "We need not to wonder why so much importance is attached to the Lord's resurrection." Listen carefully. His rising from the dead is the seal and the memorial stone of the great work of redemption. He came to redeem that which was lost. He came to do what His crowning achievement would prove. Not only did He have the words of life, He demonstrated life by rising from the dead. He paid a debt I could not pay, praise God. I owe a debt to Him that I could not pay, praise God. But He paid that debt in full. He undertook to pay it on our behalf. And guess what? When Jesus stepped into the ring to fight the enemy, He won the battle over death. He won the battle over hell. He won the battle over the grave. And that's what we come to understand, that you can put truth in the grave, but it won't stay there. Hallelujah. Jesus is the way, He is the truth, and He is the life. I want to share with you this morning an important illustration. It's entitled "An Unexpected Letter." And I believe that in this unexpected letter, it expresses so clearly, like no other words can, that what Jesus did for us is truly nothing but amazing. Please enjoy this quick video entitled "An Unexpected Letter from an Unexpected Person." Please watch the screen.
Dear Jesus, who do you think you are? You came riding into town. You claimed to be God. The people lined the streets and shouted, "Hosanna!" Oh, it looked like they loved you. But they didn't. They did not love you. They did not heed your words. They were not your friends. They were your enemies. And before the week had even ended, they crucified you. And now, here you are, nailed on a cross, naked and weak. Of course, the only reason I'm here is because I know what you're really up to. You're paying for something. You have been crowned with guilt, the shame of all the people you love. The mistakes of every person, that nagging selfishness that emerges from the womb like a cancer that never stops growing, the cheating, the backstabbing, the despicable things they wish upon others, all the secrets kept under wraps, kept behind closed doors. I can see you pushing with your feet, trying to breathe underneath the weight of it all the petty anger of prideful men, the blatant disregard for others, the lack of compassion, the insistence of entitlement, the material obsessions, the unspeakable amounts of money they spend on looking good while their fellow humans are starving. What does it feel like knowing that all of this is on you? Every divorce, every abandonment, every deadbeat dad, every gunshot, every kid lying dead in the street, the men who kidnap girls and sell their dignity for a few dollars, all the insecure rage and outbursts, the I hate you, the I'll do what I want, the pornographic addictions, the jealousy, the idols, the celebration of vanity, the constant pursuit of look at me, look at me, look at me. Well, now we're looking at you, Jesus. And all I can see is a world drowning in sin and suffering. I realize these were not your doing. Nonetheless, I'm happy for you to be taking the blame. Humanity has done a fine job with this, but I'll take it from you. Before we're done, I just have to ask, what kind of person claims he can forgive the whole world? Who do you think you are? Sincerely, Death.
Dear Death, I got your letter. My apologies for it taking a few days to write back. I had some important work to finish. I know you weren't expecting me to reply, but I'm always eager to provide the answer to a good question. Who do I think I am? I'll tell you who I am. I am the eternity before history. I am the potter who spun the galaxies. I am the spirit over the deep, and the one who tells mountains to migrate. I am the cloud of day, the fire of night. I am the co-conspirator behind the scandal of grace. I am the keeper of the books. I am well aware of the debts that line the pages of every generation, and today I am stamping each and every one of them paid in full. Who do I think I am? I'll tell you. I am the just and furious wrath that makes hell look like a campfire. And I am the towering wave of mercy that can quench its thirsty flame. I am the billowing storm of love that sits on every horizon. And my goodness rains down on both the wicked and the righteous. I am the redeemer of wasted years. I am the welcome home to every prodigal son. I am the voice in the ear of every young girl whispering, I created you, and you were created beautiful. I am faithful even to the faithless. My name is salvation. My name is power, even power over you. Do you really want to know who I am? I am the foot on your head. I am the spear in your side. I am the one author of this story. I am the one holding the pen, and I will blot you out with a single stroke of my hand. I will have the last word because I am the word. And Death, I am here to give you a word. On Friday, you weren't attending my funeral. You were attending yours. The nails in my hand will be the ones in your coffin. And just to be clear, I was not a victim of human plans, and I was certainly never a slave to you. I am the victor. I am the master. I am the one who sets the captives free. And not only have I broken your grip on me, but I will pry your fingers from all who call my name. You are done. You are powerless. Your work is null and void. Pack up your bags. Go and tell your friends. It is finished.
Mm-hmm.
And in case you're still wondering, who do I think I am? I'll tell you who. I am. Sincerely, Jesus.
I love that part of the story that says, you thought you were attending my funeral? The very shame of death and the stigma of death that they thought they could hurl on Jesus Christ has become the capstone and the corner of his greatest victory of all. He has defeated death itself. And he who is the eternal life of God has provided for us a way of escape. And so it simply comes down to this morning. As you are seated here this morning, there's one final thing that must be answered. As he says, every good question deserves an answer. And I believe that here today, this opportunity could not pass you by without God posing this question to each and every single person in this room. And God would ask, do you believe? Do you believe that Jesus is risen from the dead? Do you believe that Jesus has the power of death, hell, and the grave? Do you believe? Many people will acknowledge things about Jesus, but it's an entirely different thing to believe. Do you believe the evidence? Do you believe that Jesus is risen, and do you believe that he's coming again? If you do believe, then you must accept the full reality. Jesus was not just the man, but Jesus was the Son of God and the Son of Man. He was God in the flesh. And the reality is that every single one of us today will stand before him. And when we stand before him, he will either judge you or he will give you eternal life. You see, if we have loved him more than our own lives, if we would love him to the point that we would pick up our own cross and follow him in the strictest of obedience, then we are the ones who truly love him. But every one of us has a choice. And every single one of us will have to choose one way or the other. So I ask you, what do you choose? It is my prayer today that you come to know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, who is the Lord of life. Would you bow with me? Lord, today there may be those who are here present with us who didn't expect to be asked such a question. But this single question can change all of eternity. Lord, this single question is perhaps the most important thing that we could ever give our attention to. Lord, life itself is fleeting. Life itself is fragile. One life will soon be passed. Only what we do for Christ is going to last. Here today, yet gone tomorrow. Father, unless we answer the question, do we believe? It's not just simply knowing that Christ died. It's not simply knowing that he is raised. But have we confessed? Have we believed? Do we acknowledge that Jesus is the sacrifice, not only for the sins of the world, but for my sin? Lord, it is my prayer. It has been my thought. It has been my wish. It's been, Lord, on the heart of the Holy Spirit that today, that anyone here that would be in this room would know and would make this proper choice. Lord, we can't make that choice for them, but each one must decide for themselves. Not their mother, not their father, not the one that they came with, but they themselves must answer, do I believe? And so today I want to grant the opportunity to every person here that you would have the opportunity to acknowledge today that Jesus is the way, that Jesus is the truth, that Jesus is the life. And you can do so by simple prayer of faith. It is such a simple matter, in fact, that even children can do this. If we will but believe that Jesus was buried, he died and was buried for our sins, but on the third day that he rose again, that we can come to confess that he is my Lord and my Savior. He is the only King, the ruler of my heart. That there's no other way to the Father but through him. If we're willing to confess the name of Jesus Christ as our Lord and as our Savior, the Bible says that we will pass from death to life when we place our trust in him and the finished work that he has committed to us. Lord, I pray that, Lord, today is the day of salvation. And so, Lord, we believe. We believe that, God, you have risen from the dead so that you might give life where there was death, that you may give hope where there was hopelessness, where you, God, may restore our joy and break the power of death and break the power of sin in our lives. You live to die, and you died to live. Jesus, I pray that this morning, those of us who would call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's what the Bible tells us. And so I want to give an opportunity at this point with every head bowed and eyes closed. If you would like to say, Jesus, I need you as my Lord and Savior, would you raise your hand? If you've never confessed him, if you've never professed him, would you raise your hand today? It would be our honor and privilege to pray with you in these closing moments. Jesus, the Lamb of God. Is there anyone here today? Please have the courage. Jesus is waiting. Thank you, Lord. He knows our hearts and he knows our thoughts. He is patient and loving, but we cannot know what holds tomorrow. Today is the day of salvation, the Bible tells us. He's not willing that any should perish, but all that come to him who believe might have life and have it everlasting. God knows our hearts. He knows our thoughts. And whether or not you acknowledged by raising your hand, you can acknowledge him in your heart today by simply bringing to your heart and with your mind and with your soul, believing that the evidence of the empty tomb is not only undeniable, but his promise is unbreakable, and his love and his grace is unshakable. Father, we thank you for this. We thank you for the resurrected Savior, Jesus Christ, and we confess him as our Lord and Savior. And so, if we would just pray together this morning, this prayer, praying out loud together, dear Jesus, I come to you just as I am. I ask that you would save me from my sins. Lord, I ask that you would forgive me and cleanse me. Wash me and make me new. Give me that resurrection life. In Jesus' name, keep me in the path of your will for all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen.